Hello everyone, welcome back. I hope you've been having a great experience here at Baltic Honeybadger. I've been having a great time. I really enjoyed the talks yesterday and the day prior, the Layer 2 day. It's been a fantastic experience. I hope you're all enjoying it as well. Maybe at least you guys are the ones who turned up, you know, Sunday morning. So, you know, congrats to you, because that always happens. You know, give yourselves a round of applause. So, you know, it's always tough to be the speaker on the Sunday morning because, you know, a lot of people are hungover or they're still asleep. But we've got a fantastic speaker for you. He's actually a friend of mine. He is a fellow, you know, from the land of New Zealand. And he's a bit of a Bitcoin nomad, so he loves all that. And, you know, he first bust out into the scene. Actually, I recall he was doing some GoTenna transactions and stuff like that. And so that's where he kind of busted out into it, and he became a developer in the space. He's now a colleague of mine, actually, working at Swan Bitcoin in the engineering team. And he's always got some interesting thoughts around censorship resistance. And I think, you know, without, I'm not going to steal his thunder, but I think he's got some really interesting thoughts around where we are as a Bitcoin community. So everyone, please welcome Rigel Walshe.
Thank you, Stefan. Just give me a moment to prepare myself.
Right, so good morning, fellow Chad nerds. My name is Rigel Walshe, and my talk today is called Bitcoin Psychopaths versus Bitcoin Sociopaths, a critical examination of the meaning of mass adoption. First off, to introduce myself, who am I? So Stefan spoke a little bit about it. My name is Rigel Walshe. I'm from New Zealand originally, and I now live in Latin America. On Twitter, you might know me as CoinsureNZ. I currently work as a software engineer at Swan Bitcoin. But also, kind of, my other background is what inspired me to write the talk that I'm giving today. Ever since I was 17, I've played in a bunch of crazy metal bands and toured around the world and recorded a couple of albums. And that gave me kind of a unique insight into how subcultures work, some of the interesting politics within them, why they do or do not go mainstream, and how kind of when you've got this really emergent decentralized consensus, how the internal politics really drives the directions in which things move. But also for 10 years of my life, I worked as a police officer, and that gave me another view into a kind of different type of cliquey subculture, one where the stakes are very high, and as a consequence, rules and kind of gatekeepers play an important part in maintaining a culture and some practices that are really hard to understand as an outsider or as a newcomer. And also how these kind of behaviors can quite easily metamorphosize into what's commonly called as a toxic or sick culture. So, look, I first bought Bitcoin in 2014, but it wasn't until I started coming to conferences around the world in 2018 that it really became apparent to me just how much and there was in common with what I saw in the Bitcoin meat space and a lot of the behaviors that I'd seen with the police and with music. You know, a lot of the same mistakes and the same benefits. But it's always struck me in that time, like how little discussion or conversation there is about some of these cultural practices and how we can understand them and use them in an objective, informed way to ensure that Bitcoin succeeds. So, you know, we on Twitter, we talk about these kind of things like hyper-Bitcoinization, and we throw around, you know, the Rogers adoption S-curve here with, you know, the laggards and the late adopters and the technology adoption graph. But there's really little nuanced discussion about what it means to have an influx of noobs or uneducated new users come into a space and what that means for the culture of Bitcoin. So I wrote this article called the Bitcoin Rorschach Test, and there I made the argument that Bitcoin really is just a code repo on GitHub. It's the users and how they see themselves in Bitcoin that determines what Bitcoin is, how they use it in the real world that determines what Bitcoin actually means in practical reality. And I think Eric Voskiel said it even better than that when he said, Bitcoin is secured, not secured by blockchains, hash power, validation, decentralization, cryptography, open source, or game theory. It's secured by people. Technology is never the root of system security. Technology is merely a tool to help people secure what they value. And that security requires people to act. So Bitcoin has the potential to be censorship-resistant sound money. But if the users of Bitcoin don't care about these principles, if they prefer to go with keep all their coins on exchanges and use centralized APIs to send and receive the transactions, then it's debatable how much that remains as potential. If people are too afraid of government enforcement or exchange bans or taxes to use it as sound money, then Bitcoin really runs the risk of being captured by corporate or government interests, and indeed I believe that's the most likely way that Bitcoin could fail. So culture matters. And if culture is important, then it really, what we should do is get a bit of understanding about, kind of what cultures are. So, you know, Bitcoin, in my opinion, is definitely not mainstream. Now, obviously everyone knows what Bitcoin is, or crypto is, but we've got a very long way to go before Bitcoin is as mainstream and as boring as the cellular phone. So Bitcoin is a subculture, or really, as I would argue, like a counterculture. So what do these things mean? So a subculture is best really explained as like me and the boys, right? So you've got some friends and you've got some kind of shared in jokes outsiders don't quite get. You've got some kind of ways of seeing the world or understandings that are unique to your little group. And really that's what a subculture comes down to. It's just that on a much greater level. So subcultures that we might know out there in the world are things like this, right? So they're kind of quirky, weird hobbies that you might have, but they're not something that like preclude you from society. They're not seen as things that to be looked down on or to be pushed out. They're kind of weird hobbies, right? But there's a subgroup of subcultures called countercultures. And countercultures are subcultures that base their identity or their kind of reason for being around active opposition to some element of the mainstream. And some ones that we might know, some of the kind of more extreme ones perhaps might be things like the Amish or an outlaw motorcycle gang or a religious cult. But there are also things that are a little bit more banal, like say the hippie movement, where you're really existing inside society, but you have very strong beliefs about how society needs to change. And it's part of your kind of core identity. So countercultures interestingly enough, where a lot of the innovation and change in society comes, unsurprising really, given that they base their identity around something that needs to be changed in society. A lot of the elephants in the room are the hypocrisy about what goes on in the world. So for example, some of the first property-owning women in the United States were the madams of brothels, right? Now at the time, woman-owning property was seen as a bit weird or a bit unusual or something that perhaps was even corrosive to the fabric of society. But because they were kind of already outcast reprobates, they didn't have to deal with the social pressure that normal people did, and that gave them the space to innovate and come up with new ways of doing things. And in this example, society eventually decided that this is a really good idea and it became very mainstream. So, look, people say there's no such thing as Bitcoin culture, and I believe there's a nugget of truth to that statement. But also, when you have a bunch of people together, you have culture. There's no way you can escape that. So, if you were to lump all the different opinions and worldviews and politics of Bitcoin users, if you were to use one term to kind of describe what Bitcoin culture could be, I think probably the most accurate one that you could use is that it is a counterculture. And if we can go with that idea that Bitcoin is a counterculture, then we can look at how other countercultures have integrated into mainstream society and what some of the implications for Bitcoin might be. So some countercultures that were big edgy things at one point and now are quite normal or normalized that we might know are things like cannabis culture, or perhaps the punk rock movements, hip hop, or perhaps lesbian and gay culture. All these things at one point were very out there and very edgy and seen as very extreme kind of views, and now they've been quite normalized and they're quite just really normal part of society. Now, partly that's because they have actually changed society and that their values have become normal values in society, but also because society has commodified them as a way to sell products or to push a particular political agenda. So just as much as countercultures influence mainstream culture also influences countercultures. And generally this takes place via two means. Diffusion and diffusion. So what do these things mean? So diffusion. So if you have a counterculture and you want to take it to the mainstream or bring more of these people on board, first you need to educate them the fact that it actually exists, and secondly, about why the hell they should care about this this counterculture. So that really means is that you've got to take the idea and distill it down to something that can be communicated in a 7-second advertisement on Instagram or TikTok. You've got to take a really complex idea and reduce it to something that can be communicated in a soundbite on a billboard. And generally this means, of course, that a lot of the subtlety and nuance behind an idea gets lost. So what is defusion? Well, if you have a counterculture, obviously it stands against what mainstream cultures mean, and if you want to bring those people on board, well, you've got to meet in the middle somewhere, right? So diffusion is the idea that it's kind of the idea of watering down and making the idea in some way more appealing to some element of mainstream society. And generally all that means is depoliticizing it, making it a little nicer, playing up the elements that are acceptable or nice and good about it, and playing down the ones that are inconvenient or perhaps not so appealing to society, playing them down, adjusting the meanings, or even straight up lying and misinforming about what these things actually mean. And of course, this creates friction when you have an influx of these new people who have been led to believe this is what the counterculture is, which is often very different than the people who have been involved in that counterculture for some time and what their understandings about what it is. So via diffusion, the mainstream kind of waters down or clouds the nuance of the idea, and via diffusion, kind of it cucks it, it neuters it, it takes out a lot of the potential for radical transformative change. And usually this is for financial gain, sometimes it's for political gain, and it's not always done maliciously, right? Some people believe, you know, this idea can change the world if only we could get more people on board. But always the idea behind taking a counterculture mainstream is that numbers are more important than nuance, that having more people on board is more important than the nuance or the subtleties of the idea. So like it or not, whenever you are trying to bring a counterculture mainstream, this is the process that is taking place. So what happens in a noob invasion? When you have thousands and thousands of new people coming into a counterculture, what does that look like? Well, we can choose, I can show you three theories in the short amount of time that we have this morning to try and understand kind of how that takes place and what some of the consequences might be for Bitcoin as it becomes mainstream. So the first one is René Girard's mimetic theory. So mimetic theory states that much of what we desire is learned via imitation. So like as children, you know, we copy our parents, we mimic them to learn. And as adults, you know, we don't have the time or energy to understand and get our head around all the things that we need to do. So we look at someone that we think is successful or an influencer, if you like, and we copy what they do. So much of our desire is not spontaneous, but is in fact mimetic. We want things because other people want them. So when Bitcoin started, you know, many of the people that were coming on board were there for spontaneous reasons, right? They liked the technology, they saw the potential for transformative change. But as it becomes bigger and bigger, and of course the price goes up, you get more people that are here simply because of the volume of noise, right? They think that it's the cool new thing, that it's where the future is, and they come because of those reasons, not because they understand what Bitcoin actually is. So for example, when I was coming from the airport to the hotel for the conference in Miami, and you're seeing billboards for crypto and Bitcoin services every 500 meters, you start to attract the sort of people that are there, solely there because they see everyone talking about it and they think they've got to get on board with this thing. You get people who think that, you know, Elon Musk is a successful guy and, you know, because he's talking about Bitcoin or Dogecoin or whatever it is this week, then I should be too. So these people, they come on board because they are trying to be like Elon Musk, not because they actually want Bitcoin. And of course these people, because they're simply parroting what these influencers or these people are saying, they're unable to objectively reason about the thing, they're just simply thralls to their mimetic masters. So as more and more of these mimetic followers, if you like, come on board, we start to have this tension whereby if you're unable to really explain or reason about the thing that you're into, all you can do is really kind of copy the people that you're following and turn up the volume. And of course, when you're unable to reason, all you can do is amplify the volume, then that what that generally leads or metamorphosizes into is this kind of arms race of trying to be more and more extreme than the other people. And what happens there is that more and more of the discussion becomes focused on the internal politics and the shouting and the Twitter beefs or whatever it is that are going on in the space, and the conversation becomes less and less about the actual thing that we were here arguing about. And then, so more and more of the discussion in the space and the energy goes on to tribalism and performative displays of purity. And that creates a crisis eventually where things escalate and escalate and escalate, and people are unable to reason their way out of the corner that they're pinned themselves into, because so many people are here just because of the volume of noise and all the drama, they don't even know what the hell the thing was about. So the next one is this theory or article called Geeks, Mops, and Sociopaths, and I want to thank Sergey from Rifle for putting on to this one. So this David Chapman's article talks about what happens when you have a cool idea, how an idea becomes cool, and how newcomers and kind of nefarious actors come on board and ruin a cool thing. So cool things start with creators, and this might be software or art or religion or anything like that. You get these guys with creators. They show up, they have an idea, and they kind of riff off each other, and they create this interesting new phenomenon. And that attracts these guys, the fanatics. Now, they're not creators, but they love the idea, they're enthralled by it, and they kind of fill in the mortar and the bricks, if you like. They organize the meetups, they do the how-to videos, they provide the logistics. And many kind of geeky things stay at this kind of level, right? You know, but if the thing is interesting enough, and importantly, if it's simple enough, or can be explained simply enough for, you know, someone with not too much technical knowledge to understand, then we get the next group, the mops. And these are the people that are here really just to have a good time, to soak up all the good stuff and contribute as little as possible, right? Complain about how everyone else should be fixing the thing that they're doing. And so these guys, you know, they come aboard, the geeks and the creators and the fanatics, they want to talk about the thing all day. These guys just want to talk about sport and fad diets and politics. And they start to treat the fanatics like wait staff. And at this point, you know, the creators and the fanatics can start to get a little bit jaded about the process. And also, unfortunately, this is when our final group shows up, the sociopaths. So now these guys, they don't give a fuck about the idea. They're just here. They see that the creators have created cultural capital. The fanatics have created social capital. The mops have brought liquid capital, cash. And they see an opportunity to exploit all three of these things. So they sing this song to the mops about how the creators have got it all wrong, and it can be, you know, nice and easy and convenient. And to the mops, you know, they look and sound like the creators, just that, you know, they talk smoother and they dress better. Well, debatably, dress better. And so, you know, they sing the siren song to the mops, and they follow and they follow. And while they're hypnotized by the words of the sociopaths strip mine the thing for all the money, sex, and power that they can. And they leave it gutted and without soul and without all the cool that brought the thing in the first place. The mops start to slowly dissipate, and the sociopaths move on to the next thing they can be some inspiring thought leader of. So the last theory is the Eternal September, and this is a reference to the early days of the internet. And basically in the early 90s, the internet was this kind of geeky thing where there wasn't many people on board. But one of the first kind of mediums to really take off on the internet was this thing called Usenet, which is kind of roughly along the lines of what we would understand today as forums, right? So in those days, to be on Usenet, you really had to have a university email. And so it was a small group of people on there. And this is the first time that you could talk about all sorts of geeky niche things with people all over the world. It's this great new phenomena. But every September, you'd have an influx of new college freshmen who would show up with a sparkling new university email in hand. And they'd fuck the thing up for a couple of months. They'd come in there, not understanding how it works, typing in all caps, all these kind of things. And after, it would take a couple of months for the existing users to educate them on the netiquette of how Usenet should be used. But in 94, AOL started offering Usenet to all the users. And what that meant was an influx of thousands and thousands and thousands of new people coming aboard every day, day after day, week after week, month after month. So at that point, it was always September on Usenet. You know, the fucking new guy was the norm and not the exception. And what that really meant is it, you know, really fundamentally changed the culture of internet forever. And some people say, you know, the beauty of what existed then was lost forever and the internet has never been the same. And really, we are at a similar point with Bitcoin. We are deep, I believe, now into Bitcoin's Eternal September. We've got wave after wave of new user coming aboard who don't understand things like, for example, people have seen recently with Celsius, so, you know, not your keys, not your coins. And these are things that are difficult to articulate in a Medium article or a tweet. They need to be learned and experienced. It's kind of like information that a parent imparts onto a child. But, you know, the Eternal September is wave after wave of these news people coming through. Like, imagine you ran a restaurant and you had customer after customer coming in not knowing how to use a knife and a fork, and you have to show them how to do it, right? This is what we face with Bitcoin's Eternal September. So, you know, it's on us really to impart that culture onto these new people, because they're not going away. It's always September in Bitcoinistan now, and we need to take ownership for this process and impart onto these new users what this culture is. Otherwise, things will go just as they did with the internet. So, to conclude, you know, kind of what can we draw from what we've talked about today? What are some closing points that we can do? So the first one is that Bitcoin is a counterculture, and that means that as we progress, there's this kind of zero-sum trade-off, existential tension between the mainstream, the status quo, and Bitcoin, right? You know, as Bitcoin will give, it will take, and vice versa. So that begs the question, do we want Bitcoin to be as mainstream and ubiquitous as the cellular phone? And if not, what is the line in the sand that we want to proceed up to and step, not one step further over? And, you know, for example, you know, is KYC an acceptable thing if it's going to, the way that's going to bring on thousands of new users? Fediments, the appropriate way to onboard a host of the world that at this point hasn't come on to Bitcoin, when, you know, at this point it is as simple as remembering 24 words. You know, what are the answers to these things? If we don't have the answers to these questions, then other people will decide them for us. So, you know, there's a trade-off between numbers and nuance, and the only solution that we can come to for that is trying to think of what are the core ideals of Bitcoin culture that we want to impart onto new users, and how can we distill them into as subtle, sound-biteable snippets as we can without losing the nuance and having them clouded in ambiguity. It's always September in Bitcoinistan, so you can complain about it on Twitter, or you can do something about it. You know, we should forgiveth the noobs, for they knoweth not what they do. And we need to leave the door open to educate them, to show them, to teach them the principles, and importantly, to give them the space to reason objectively and understand about what Bitcoin is. Because if you don't, then what you're left with is mimetic noise. A bunch of people who simply parrot the words of influencers or people on Twitter, and that is fertile ground for sociopaths and personality cults. So in closing, David Chapman's theory would state that cool ideas get ruined by people that come on without a reverence for its principles, right? They're acting purely in their own self-interest, and they don't realize that, in this sense, altruism is self-interest. But if we haven't educated them on what that altruism actually means in practice, what those principles are, then how can they act in that way? So it's on us to distill these ideas and to disseminate these ideas to the newcomers that are coming aboard and to the sociopaths that would use Bitcoin for their own nefarious ends to defend it, and defend it like a fucking psychopath. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thanks very much, Rigel. I really enjoyed that talk. I think there's a lot there that we as a community have to think about. You know, are we just living in this eternal September, and how do we deal with the noobs? So, okay. So just give me a moment. I just want to check we've got our next panelists all ready to go. So we've got our security panel coming up. So once again, we've got... those of you from yesterday, you'll be familiar with Daniel Prince. He is the host of the Once Bitten Bitcoin podcast. Is Daniel around? Oh, yeah. Okay, you guys are there. Gotcha. Sorry. All right, cool. Well, everyone, welcome Daniel up to stage, and we'll get our security panel underway.
Check. Okay. Yeah, we're good. Right, everybody, thank you so much for showing up today. Hangovers in tow, I am sure. Thank you for that amazing talk there. I think I would be probably described as a LARPing mop as I sit up here with these guys right now, Can I have a show of hands? Who actually gave one single fuck about privacy before they come to Bitcoin? Yeah, not bad. Who did not give any fucks about privacy and doxed themselves all over the internet for most of their adult life before they came to Bitcoin and now are regretting everything that they've done in the past? Probably most of the room. So we're going to go around. You guys introduce yourself first, and then we'll get into some questions. I might just open it very early to Q&A because we've got a bunch of guys in here that probably got much better questions than myself. But we'll see how it goes. So we'll start with you, Douglas, and a quick intro and tell us what you do and why.
Hi, I'm Douglas Bakkum. I invented a hardware wallet called the Bitbox, and now I created a company to develop it called Shift Crypto. I'm the CEO now. So moving away from the, what was the first one? The creators, unfortunately.
I'm Peter Todd. I've spent a lot of time on things like Bitcoin Core and so on, reading about other people's ideas and then criticizing them, which is a remarkably large part of what security is, because you know you can't test your way to security. You got to look at something and find the little tiny flaws that we'd never find by chance.
So some of you might have seen my intro before, but my name is Rigel Walshe. I work at Swan Bitcoin as an engineer, but my reason for being on here is that I spent 10 years in the police, including the last kind of period I was in the, what's the equivalent of the Secret Service at home, taking care of the Prime Minister. So I guess I'm the guy speaking about physical security here today, and if you're interested in seeing that, I've given a few talks about this topic on a few other conferences.
Literally a Fed.
Hi, my name is Pavol Rusnak. I am the co-founder of Satoshi Labs, the company behind Trezor, which was the first and still is the first hardware wallet. And I've been in Bitcoin since forever, and I'm also the author of BIP39 and some other standards that are being used by literally every software and hardware wallet out there.
All right, thank you. Now, who out there is going to be brave, put their hand up and ask a question rather than just sit there slinging shit on Twitter like we saw this morning? Anybody want to throw their hand up and ask a question of this panel whilst you have them? There is one over there. All right.
So for anyone really, but Pavel especially, how important is it that open source software is MIT licensed rather than GNU licensed?
Rather, you said MIT or what? What's the other option?
From GNU license.
You mean GPL.
Yeah. That's a good question. I think it really depends on what you are trying to achieve. Bitcoin is a good example. Satoshi chose an MIT license because they wanted everybody to use the software, while we have chosen GPL license for Trezor because we also want basically everybody to use the software, but we also want to people that are building on top of our stack to also publish all of their changes. So there is like a limitation to what you can do with the source, but I think it's a good limitation because it's a good intent behind that. Another example is, for example, 95% of JavaScript libraries are MIT licensed because creators of these libraries probably want them to be used by closed source companies, and maybe they will got hired by companies that are building closed source, but this is really not my intention with Trezor. I don't want my code to be used in closed environments, so this I have chosen the more strict license.
I mean, actually, maybe a quick question. I'm kind of curious. What percentage of the audience knows the difference between MIT and GPL licenses? Like, raise your hands. Yeah, okay, half-ish. I mean, maybe I should quickly comment. So open source, of course, is where you go give away your source code. MIT is where you give away with no conditions. GPL is where you give away with the condition that if you're going to use this and redistribute it, you should also give away your source code. And this is why I would say I think it's a real problem that the security industry is in the rest of the open source community in general is moving to MIT licenses, because you know we need that kind of viralness to go and keep software open. You know, it's a real problem that like a lot of the stuff on my phone, there is no way to go get the source code to it. You know, there's no way to go see what my phone's actually doing. And you know, I think like Satoshi probably made the right decision in releasing Bitcoin as MIT for that adoption, but there's real advantages to GPL too, and I think as a total, our security posture everywhere is lessened by it, so.
Maybe just a small addition, since this is a Bitcoin conference, and I hinted that MIT might have been a good choice for Bitcoin. And imagine if Bitcoin used a license that would make it impossible to integrate Bitcoin code into exchanges. So is it a good thing and bad thing? I mean, you would be able to trade a lot of altcoins there, but not Bitcoin.
To be clear, the way GPL works is you can use it in closed source software, such as an exchange backend. But if you were to then redistribute that exchange backend to someone else, GPL forces it to be open while MIT doesn't. And you know, we actually don't see that as much as we used to, because of course these days software as a service is such a big thing. You know, like how often do you go and buy a copy of Exchange source code? Like basically nobody does that anymore. It's always a hosted thing that you're using. So it's, you know, it's a different world than how GPL kind of came to be.
Yeah. There are even more drastic licenses like AGPL that make it even worse for people using that even if they are integrated, then in a mixed environment, they would need to publish any source touching that. But I think we are really, really in the detail right now, and we might roll up back.
I see you nodding your head in agreement, Douglas. Anything to add before we go on to the next question? No.
No, I think they covered it quite well.
Nope. Not my area of specific expertise, I would say.
Great question, though. Thank you very much. We already have another hand up down the front here. This is working well.
Thank you. I'm always worried about attacks, especially covert attacks. So I'd like to know if there's any way that a user can make sure that something like reuse of nonces is impossible in a hardware wallet. Can I verify that the hardware wallet doesn't screw up the nonce so they can derive my private key from a transaction I signed? Is there any way?
Yeah, I mean,
maybe we should explain quickly like what the significance of this is.
Yeah, maybe you can.
Yeah. Oh, so basically speaking, so the way the digital signature system in Bitcoin works, and believe me, I'm glossing over details here, but basically speaking, you have to go come up with a random number as part of the process of making a new signature. And if you don't come up with a random number, you can reveal your private key and like all hell breaks loose and you lose your money. And this is really hard to go audit, because how do you know that the hardware wallet internally is actually creating a random number? It's tricky.
Yeah, and basically, at least to my knowledge, there are like two different approaches how to solve the problem. And one of them is using deterministic nonces. So there is like algorithm that describes how a nonce should be created. And you can verify that the hardware wallet is actually using that algorithm by two steps. First, you need to have an open source hardware wallet, such as Trezor. And then you need to have an environment that is able to deterministically build the software so you can actually verify that the binary distributed by Satoshi Labs is actually coming from that source that it's claiming to come from. And this is the approach we use. But also there is another approach to introduce like more complex protocol, which is called Klepto protocol.
Yeah, anti-klepto.
Anti-klepto protocol, and this is something that Bitbox uses, and I guess Douglas is the best person to describe how it works.
I can try to describe that. So another way, so I guess to rephrase the attack is with this random nonce, this random number, you can actually leak secrets out through signatures, and your signatures are on the public blockchain. And so someone, that's available to everyone. And so you can't leak out the whole secret, you can leak out little bits, but over time you can leak out different bits of a secret and actually exfiltrate your seed onto the public blockchain. and the attacker would put little markers on it so they know what's wrong, or they know where to look to get that. And so there's a technique that's been developed by some engineers in our company, along with, I think, with some engineers from Blockstream, to basically add, so there's cryptographic magic here, but basically from the software app, you can add an extra nonce, and when you get the signature out through cryptographic magic, you can prove that this was added to the nonce. And so by doing this, you're adding in a source of randomness that's not linked to the attacker, and you can basically bypass this attack.
And maybe I'll quickly speak to, like, I think the wider, like, sort of social context of this, where what's tricky with these types of attacks is, you know, the way the community as a whole defeats them ultimately comes down to you have to somehow force the use of open source software, and also you have to somehow get enough people interested to actually go audit it. You know, have I personally ever bothered, like, getting my Trezor, which actually I don't use for various reasons, but, you know, getting my Trezor and actually doing all the work to verify that it works the way I claim? No, I mean, it's a whole bunch of work, and chances are it does work, and, you know, it's hard to incentivize people to actually do this stuff. You know, academics seem to go do it sometimes, but they seem to rely on underpaid grad students who often don't really understand these issues, and it's you know, it's tough in a community just to build in the interest, keep auditing things.
Yeah, for sure. That's a great point. I know at Trezor ourselves, we have bug bounty programs. So if there's anyone out there who thinks they can hack our hardware wallets, please do it. We'll reward you. So try it. And yeah, this is the challenge. We make code, we make it open source. But the big part of making it open source, like you say, is people should verify it. So we want you to verify it.
And actually, that was the main reason why we came up with the idea for the hardware wallet, because me and Slash, we were and we still consider ourselves as a software engineers, and believe me, we didn't really want to create a hardware wallet, but since we were trying to solve the problem of self-custody, we realized there is simply no other way than just creating an environment that it is possible to audit. I mean, not everybody is forced to audit it, but at least there is a possibility that a single person can verify both hardware and software. I mean, the Trezor firmware is around 100,000 lines of code, which might be a lot, but it is doable. I mean, a person can audit probably single line of code, every single line of code in maybe a year. But compare it to like Android operating system or Windows, which has hundreds, millions lines of code. It's just impossible to audit. And we wanted to provide this rather small environment, which is doable to audit.
Rigel, I want to bring you in here because obviously we have hardware makers here. You are working at Swan, where you are probably trying to educate as many people as you can for the reason to self-custody and to buy one of these devices. I'm hoping we're going to get 100% hands up. Who owns a hardware wallet of some sort? If your hand's down, take note. So how do you go about that, educating the people that you're being onboarded at Swan and getting that message across, which you were kind of talking about in your talk there?
Yeah, I mean, I think our company's objective is to try and target the newcomers, or perhaps we lean a little bit towards some of the less educated people in the space, or at least we provide the ability for those people to be taken care of, which I think is something that most of these the Alcon exchanges, they don't really have that kind of customer focus, if you like. But it's also an important part of, as you alluded to, that this education is more than just a way to sell Bitcoin to people. It's a very important part about the future of the ecosystem, because if a significant amount of the economic activity happens on centralized exchanges, or people don't self-custody, then effectively Bitcoin has been captured, you could answer. So we have a real focus. I mean, we definitely have a lot of customers that are, some of them have spoken at this conference, that don't need our advice on the stuff. They're relatively well advised. But, I think it is very important, something that we do offer for any of those of you out there that do need that we are able to provide somewhat of that concierge service to people. And I think it is a very important thing, because these fundamental principles about, as we've been talking about with open source licenses, but also hardware wallets and many other things, you know, it's this culture of security, which is something which I feel is quite lacking in Bitcoin. You know, certainly
given my professional background, people are a bit lax in some ways, which I find interesting, but it's understandable. You know, these are normal people. But I think, you know, making a real effort to make that part of our mission and to educate people about that is something that's very important, and that's something that we try and push. So come to us at SWAN if you need advice.
Excellent. And I think that the question on everybody's lips, to air gap or not to air gap? And I see Douglas, I think we're going to pass that one over to you. First of all, Peter, actually, would you explain to people that might not understand what we're talking about, what air gap or not air gap is? And then Douglas can get into that. And we're going to have NVK online to, you know, live from Canada.
So you asked me to explain it also. Yeah.
Yeah, go for it. Yeah. You go for it. Yep.
So stealing my thunder a little bit, I actually have a talk at 11:30. Hopefully I'm on time on the other stage exactly on this topic. But yeah, air gap. So hardware wallets need to communicate with a computer or mobile phone. There's different ways you can communicate. One is just with USB. Just plug it in. Very straightforward. That's what we do. That's what Trezor does. There's a concept out there called air gap, which is not using USB. They say that there's a gap of air between the computer and the hardware wallet, and that could be either, there still needs to be communication, and so that can either be through micro SD cards being transferred between the two devices, or QR codes, so like photons through the air, through the two devices. And yeah, there's some belief in the field that this adds security. In my talk, I'm going to argue that that's maybe a bit more questionable. I'll stop there for now.
You know, I mean, pre-Bitcoin, I actually worked in analog electronics design, you know, at actually a geophysics startup. And funny enough, I did actually go build a literal air gap at one point to go transfer power through, you know, a couple hundred watts worth. So, but, you know, I think, like, air gaps, the whole discussion around it, I think it often misses bigger factors. Like, you know, if you have a wire between your hardware wallet and your computer, that isn't necessarily a bad thing. The question is, how did you design that wire? Which can get down to, you know, depending on what your threat model is, can get down to really subtle issues, like, well, like, how much current? Well, you know, I mean, how many electrons literally per second are flowing through that wire, and how fast can that number change? And one of my earliest Bitcoin talk posts was actually a bit of analog electronics design, talking about how, well, you know, one of the ways that a device can leak information is by how much power it's consuming. Because as it does some hard crypto operation, it uses more power. And then when it stops doing that hard crypto operation, it uses less. Well, often the length of time that it's doing that hard crypto operation is dependent on the secret data. And now you have a problem. Well, what's one way to go and do the important part of an air gap? It's to go and do some, you know, electronics wizardry to go make sure that that amount of current stays the same. And, you know, there's lots of details like that, but I don't think it's, like, just to go say, oh, we'll use an SD card. I'm very dubious by that kind of talk because, you know, what's an SD card? Well, an SD card these days is an entire, like, 32-bit microprocessor, and they've got amazing amounts of complexity. Like, I'd much rather see more places just go focus on, you know, what's a simple design that we can really go argue well, as well as also probably in the usually more important case of, well, where did the hardware come from and so on. You know, frankly, I personally don't bother using hardware wallets. I'd much rather go buy a, you know, used laptop from somewhere that's very unlikely to be specifically targeted, you know, and then go put a clean OS on it. And, I mean, literally, you know, I go put a tiny little laptop in a safe.
Yeah, okay. I think that the whole security debate has so much nuance, and people have only like 10 seconds of attention span, that it really comes to boiling down like very complex stuff into very simple statements, like this is air-gapped, this is not, this is secure element, this doesn't have secure element. And I think there is a lot of complex explanations to be done, but we simply don't have time because people just stop listening. Maybe you stop listening already. But what I wanted to say that, yeah, I agree with Peter that SD cards these days has more computing powers than my first computer. And also there is air gap and air gap. So I think that if we are talking about air gap, we should be talking about electromagnetic shielded air gap. So for example, printed QR code is air gap, or maybe infrared, you might remember it from the 90s. It is like sort of air gap, but fiddling with SD cards, I don't consider that an air gap. And also, when it comes to the topic of USB, yeah, people might be argumenting, yeah, there are these bad USB attacks, but actually they got it a little bit wrong, because bad USB is about a device attacking your host, not a host attacking your device. So actually, I'm more afraid to plug in SD cards into my computer than using it for any other reason, because I'm afraid that this SD card might exfiltrate some data from my computer. So yeah, I mean, this is one point, and the other point is, I think we should be thinking about like security threat modeling, and I think that a security threat model of a regular person is very different to security threat model of Edward Snowden, for example. And what we are trying to do is to tackle the problems of 99% of the people. But if you have a three-letter agency that is coming after you, I agree that you should be using something very, very different than off-the-shelf hardware or off-the-shelf hardware wallet or something else.
Yeah, if I could just chip in one thing there. I mean, I think we have the, pardon me for putting it this way, we have the security, the electronic part of security, I think, well in hand, or relatively well in hand, compared to some of the other issues to do with some of the physical, not so much physical attacks, but physical issues, but also user education, right? Like you're saying, like, it's all good and well having, you know, a great hardware wallet, but if people are too lazy to use it the right way, or they never bother to do it, or it's too complicated and so that just sits in a shelf and it stays on Binance or something like that, then, you know, then it's all for naught, right? So the security battle is more than simply the technology. It's the user, and it's also the meat space is a very important part of it.
Yeah, that's a very good point. I think that education is very important, because you can have as secure hardware world as possible, but then a user receives an email that says, something happened to your hardware wallet that is locked in your drawer, but better to enter your seed words into this fishy looking website. And that they will happily do so, even though their hardware wallet has been unused for 2 years. So we have to educate people. And I think that a lot of people that are advocating for more complex hardware solutions are really diluting the debate up to the point then the very important points are getting lost in discussion.
This is why I keep on telling people who aren't really sure about this stuff, look, do you have an old cell phone? Just put a Bitcoin wallet on it and get it off Binance.
Any other questions out there? Straight away, young lady here in the front row. Thank you.
Thank you. Hi. I wanted to ask, when you're looking at the current state of Bitcoin security, what do you consider to be the kind of hardest issue that we should be focusing on, but we're not really, that we kind of derailed? And what is, according to your word, like focusing on? What's, according to you, like, worth focusing on, and we are not really, like, focusing on?
Yeah, but the question was, like, what is the most pressing issue of security we should be focusing on, but we are not really focusing on, because we are focusing on some other crap.
I can go, no one else. I mean, kind of linking to what I said before, again, you know, I'm hesitant to say that we have the electronic side of things well in hand, but I think relatively speaking, you know, that's not the biggest of our problems. User education, but also, you know, one thing that I think is, since the last time I talked about this topic here, that has become more and more of an issue is, for example, you know, the Ledger hack and other companies, and also some other
third-party providers, you know, like Klaviyo and HubSpot and some people like that have been hacked, you know. Think about the fact that it's all good and well having your hardware wallet taken care of, but, if it comes to someone coming to your door or whatever it is, how are you going to handle that issue? And that's something that I don't think that we're really thinking about because, you know, if there is that honeypot there of people's personal information, then, you know, it can be used. I think there's a lot of talk about these strategies, but people, I think Jameson Lopp gave a very good talk about this, I think it was 2018 here, about some of these things. One of the most practical ways that people should be dealing with this stuff, which I did look through the ledger leak and very few people seem to do this, very easy to open an LLC or a company or even sometimes just using a mailbox will suffice, but using some of these kind of shell entities, if you like, to be able to satisfy the legal requirements for identity that these people need, but also to provide some distance between you and your personal information and what these companies have, is something which I think is very underutilized in the space. Also, you know, like it's just as simple as, you know, most of these people want a utility bill and they want something to legally prove your address, but that doesn't have to be where you are actually living, and there's many ways, if you're clever about that, about how you can provide some space between you and your physical location. One thing I think a lot of people should have the threat model in their head that your information will be doxxed and it will be out there. What does that mean for you? And if you're uncomfortable with that situation, if you haven't got that well handled, there's this book called The 36 Stratagems. I don't know if you've heard it. It's kind of like The Art of War. It says, of all the 36 ways to get out of trouble, the easiest is to leave. And I think that's kind of what I'm speaking to here, is if you just remove yourself from the thing, it's better than building up an army or buying a ton of guns or whatever. So think about how you can create some distance between your personal details and whatever is passed on to these companies is a very practical security tool that's relatively easy to accomplish.
I saw a meme, I think, on Twitter. I don't know who posted it, but about the $5 wrench attack. And the best way, it's now like inflation, is it? But the best way to beat the $5 wrench attack was to buy a $10 wrench.
But, exactly.
So speak to Rigel after.
You're not going to win that game, especially when, I mean, I think if you've seen what's happened the last couple of years with COVID, you know, you've got to get real that, you know, it might have seemed pretty Alex Jones before, and it may not be in the way that you anticipated, but, you know, the state level stuff is not some crazy idea, or it may be also taken into mind of, I know some people that have this problem of, I'm smart, I've got my words hidden in some other country, but now you can't get to that other country or get out of your own country, you know. It's important to start thinking about these things, and I would like it not to go in this direction, but looking at some of the economic mayhem that's happening now, it's not out of reality, so do start having that conversation with yourself.
Maybe I'll go answer that just from a software and hardware developer's point of view. The one that, you know, really concerns me, and of course it's well known, but like very little is actually done about this, is ultimately the supply chain attacks, where, you know, I mean, you know, people in the audience may not understand this, but like when you go write software, the way it actually gets turned into the bits that the CPU executes is through compilers. Those compilers use libraries, and it's kind of like, you know, having this gigantic factory of an enormous number of industrial robots that are, you know, taking your instructions and turning in software at the other end. But these systems are so insanely complex, it's basically impossible for someone to go audit what comes out the other end and verify that it actually did what you thought it did. Which means that we have to somehow audit the machine that does this and make sure we understand what software went into our software. And unfortunately, like, we're going backwards on this. You know, there used to be more, for instance, PGP signatures on software, so you could say, all right, this really came from who I thought it did. And that's disappearing now as so-called security experts in the community try to go push against this and create systems like, you know, Rust Cargo, where you have these gigantic thousands upon thousands of packages. And it's hard, you know, these things tend not to go refer to each other cryptographically. They refer to each other by, you know, version number. What does 0.1.0 mean? Well, you're really trusting third parties to turn that into the actual software you're running. And this really needs to improve, because, you know, even if you're using a hardware wallet, it's very easy for the people who make the hardware wallet to accidentally screw up by allowing one of their pieces of software that builds all this stuff to get infected by something that changes, you know, what they thought they were building to something else, such as code that steals your software. And you know, these problems are just going to continue, and we're already seeing a bit of this. And it's such a major threat that something that, because these build systems tend to get used in very wide, you know, wide parts of the ecosystem, you could have hacks through this that, you know, steal billions of dollars at a time. And these are the things that can undermine confidence in the entire system.
I think there is one topic that is neglected a lot when it comes to security, and it's nice to have your Bitcoin secured, but in the end you probably want to use them, or maybe you might want your children to use them. And if you make your setup very secure and complex, you might either shoot yourself in your foot. It happens a lot. Like, I remember a lot of users are, for example, not writing their seeds in the correct order, but they try to be smart and shuffle the order, and then they screw up because they don't remember. Or even worse, like, they make so complex setup that it's completely unreachable by their children in case they die. And Josef had a really nice talk yesterday about Shamir secret and inheritance. So basically the idea there was that you should try to document your setup, so even a person that is reading the instructions and can't interact with you for whatever reason can reconstruct your access to Bitcoin. And this is something that a lot of people are neglecting because they are really excited about how smart they were about securing their Bitcoins, but they don't really realize that problem. And there might be something like unexpected, like the obvious unexpected thing is that you die, and this is something that might occur in your head. But we have seen cases recently when people from Ukraine had to leave their countries like at 4 a.m. and then they moved to Czech Republic, and then they realized, all right, so I have my treasure in Prague, but I'm still stuck in Ukraine because I'm a male and I cannot leave. So how do I deliver the passphrase to my wife without sending it via unsecure channel, be it a SMS or a phone call, and we don't use PGP. So this is something that is not really on the top of your mind when you are creating your setup, and your secure setup should be should stand the test of time. It should be usable even in 10 years' time or 15 years' time. So you shouldn't try to come up with your own solutions. Just use one of the well battle-tested solutions.
So, like, your memory is not as good as you think it is.
No.
You know, if you do something even remotely complex with your setup, and then you go back in 5 years to go and get your Bitcoin, there's a really good chance you're going to forget what the heck you actually did.
Yeah.
You know, upstairs there's a whole bunch of like hardware seed storage solutions. One of the things that bothers me about them is you get all these things apparent, they're fancy, they're made of metal, but there's nowhere to go label them. What is this?
Yeah, I can give some expert advice here also. So I actually have a PhD in neuroscience with a focus on learning and memory. Just don't trust your brain. Just don't. It's not going to work after a while.
Guys, I'm getting the shut it down face from Stefan here. So, ladies and gentlemen, please give a big round of applause for these guys, for the hard work that they are doing to keep our Bitcoin safe. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Daniel. And thank you, gents, on the panel. That was a great one, talking about what's really topical in the space. From a security perspective. So next up, we have our next guest is Mikhail Chobanyan. He's the founder of Kunom, and he's also the president of the Ukrainian Blockchain Association. So everyone, please welcome Mikhail to the stage.
Good morning, everyone. Let's start with getting to know each other. So the first time I heard about the Bitcoin, when the price was $3. So raise your hands if you were in Bitcoin before that. Okay, only one person. $10? Okay, let's start with 100, I get it. Nope? Okay. So as you can get from the flag, I'm Ukrainian. So I own the Kuna exchange. It's a local crypto exchange. We started back in 2015. The way we started was in November, my apartment was raided by the police, and they were looking for the physical Bitcoins and the documents that could prove that I do Bitcoin exchanges, OTC. So it started with that. I was the first guy who was whose apartment was raided by the police in Ukraine, and I used that thrust, I'll call it, and converted into hype around me, and then I did the first at the time it was not ICO, it was the crowd sale. Yeah, that was the word, crowd sale. So a bunch of guys here are one of the first guys who we started the crypto in Ukraine. And since then, yeah, we created the Blockchain Association of Ukraine. And where's the clicker, by the way? Oh, here we go, yeah. Thank you, yep. So unfortunately, now we spend most of the time not dealing with the crypto. We spend most of the time dealing with the war. As you know, the war started on the, well, the major phase started on 24th of February. And we immediately decided that it's time to help the country with the new ways. Because if you can remember, in the first even month, most of the countries were not active with helping Ukraine. And basically, it was only us, the crypto guys, who were there. So we launched the website where we said, guys, my country is in trouble. We don't have anything, like nothing. The only things that the guys on the front line have, like the old AKs back from 1960s with the old bullets, and that's it. No helmets, no bulletproof vests, nothing. So we started this humanitarian fund. And we raised almost $70 million, all of it in crypto. Most of it came in Bitcoin. Then it was Ether, and then it was USDT, and then the rest of the, as we call it here, shitcoins. What we used that money for, we actually bought all the supplies for the guys on the front line. And it was done all through the crypto. The key takeaway from this point is not, I'm not here to brag, I'm here to say that how efficient the crypto is in the extreme scenarios that I just described to you. Because the banking system in Ukraine is highly inefficient due to inefficient national bank. You probably know that it happens in most of the countries. But just to give you an example, so the average transaction, because I said the most we got in the Bitcoin, is like 30 minutes with the three confirmations. So it took 30 minutes for the guys who donated to you, get the money to you, to us. And then it took us another 30 minutes to send that Bitcoin to the guys in Europe who sold us bulletproof vests. So altogether, 1 hour. Okay, one more hour for the, like, someone forgot to, like, put the address, like, immediately, all that stuff. So, like, 2 hours. With the banking system, when we exchanged crypto to fiat, because not everyone accepts crypto, but now everyone accepts crypto in Ukraine, and a lot of people and companies accept crypto in Europe as well. So we exchanged the crypto in Europe for the euros. Then we had to send euros to Ukrainian company, because that's the way you can import stuff into Ukraine. So that takes about 3 days. And then if you want to wire the money out of Ukraine, it's going to take another 3 days. So altogether, it's 6 days, and it's only 5 working days in a week. So you understand that the minimum amount of time that you need just to pay for the goods is like 7 days minimum, or actually it's 8. And imagine the first days of a war when, you know, the mess is happening and no one has anything, and we save 8 days just for the payment. So that's the true power of a crypto. 8 days. Imagine 8 days staying on the front line without anything. You know, it's crazy. It's crazy. So, What is the Blockchain Association of Ukraine? It's the group of people who are passionate about the crypto. And the reason why I asked when you started doing the crypto, because when I joined the crypto, that was I started in 11, but full-time since 13. So for me, the major thing was that here's the Bitcoin. It's a new peer-to-peer cash payment system. But the beauty of it is that we are here to change the world. That was my perception back in 2013. At the time, it was only Bitcoin, the major crypto, and everyone was talking about the bricks of Bitcoin, and everyone was talking about how we're going to change the world. And unfortunately, then we had the era of ICOs, then we had the era of DeFi's, NFTs, and all that bullshit that basically, you know, destroyed the idea of changing the world, but not in the minds of the crypto community of Ukraine. Because we still, there is this very good chance to actually execute all the Bitcoin maximalist things that we had in mind back then, and now they're like more solid and we can use them now. So this is the fund I told you about. So this is what it looks like. The pretty of it, now the tricks. So when you say crypto, you immediately think it's like opposite to the government. That's how we intend it to be, yeah? The unique scenario in Ukraine that if you can see there in the top left corner, it says Ministry of Digital Transformation of Ukraine. So that's the first ministry in the world that together with the crypto community created the humanitarian fund, crypto fund, to serve, to save people on the front line, to help people evacuate from the other places, and so on and so on. So the crypto actually infiltrated Ukrainian government right now. So we have pretty much every ministry now talks about the Bitcoin. Most of them has wallets. And the leaders are obviously the Ministry of Digital Transformation. So what else they do? Every Ukrainian has an app. It's called DIA, Держава і Я, so state and I, that's a direct translation. And this is the app where you have all your digital documents. So I have my passports there, I have my driving license, I have my car registration, birth certificates for my kid, I have my tax number, and all these documents are equal to the paper equivalent. That's like the first country in the world. So before the war, when you leave the home, all I had to take with me is my phone and the keys from my car. Because the driving license is here, the registration is here, the passport is here, you didn't need the paper document. That's a really cool thing. And now let's think of this as the not just a cool app, but as a technology. So it's basically Web 2 technology, which is really convenient. There are questions about the privacy, the previous panels, but still it works. In like here or in Europe, anywhere, you have to carry with you all the paper documents, and that's crazy. So they even say it on the website. So it's a Web 2 government. And now the beautiful thing. Since the Ministry of Digital Transformation already has the crypto wallets, since we have the ministry, which is crypto-friendly, and most of the minister is 32 years old, most of the team is like under 35, and they're very crypto-proactive, as you can understand. And I'm thinking, what if we take it the next level? So back in 2013, we were thinking about how we can change the world, how we can change the government, how we can change the way we communicate among ourselves, how we trade, how we exchange values between each other. So right now, the war is happening in Ukraine. The war is happening in Russia, in Belarus. They don't feel it, but it's happening in their minds as well. And the biggest problem and the challenge that I see right now is the lack of ideas. So what I'm here is not to present you something. I'm here to ask for the ideas. For those guys who remember the 13, when we were crazy and passionate about changing the world, I'm here to talk to you guys. So please communicate with me if you have ideas how we can build the new world order. Nothing to do with the Masons, by the way, just the new world order. How we can use the Web3 and how we can use the pro-digital government of Ukraine to change the Ukraine, because let's you know, take a few steps forward. Yeah? Sooner or later, the war will stop. And we're going to have the devastated country with ruined economy, with destroyed buildings in the whole regions, and we have old, inefficient capitalist system, and we're at this point. And the question is, what do we do? I mean, do we rebuild the buildings? If we rebuild the buildings, why are we rebuilding them? Do we transform the economy from the exporting steel ore and other resources into something digital? Or do we go fully digital? What do we do? Do we go to metaverse? Do you understand the amount of questions that we have right now? But the beauty of it, that because there are lack of ideas, literally, I mean, if you spend like half a day, try to read what's happening in Ukraine and Russia, and what are the messages that the leaders of these countries are proclaiming, none of them will have anything to do with the ideology. None. They don't say where we're going, why we're going there, what are the goals, nothing like that. And the only smart people in the world that I know and who are always thinking about this are the crypto guys. So guys, if you have any ideas how we can use the this situation for our benefit, I'm in. So I spend 95% thinking about this, connecting the people, connecting the puzzle. And the big question for me, for the holder of Bitcoin, like 90% of my wealth is in Bitcoin, I'm thinking how we can use the Bitcoin, the father of all. Do we have ideas how we can use it? Is it reserve currency for the future of the new digital economy? Or do we go, as I listened yesterday on the panels, we use Lightning Network, we use sidechains, maybe, I don't know. Do you use the RGB, the Ukrainian guys here from Pandora presented yesterday, how you can do the smart contracts on the Bitcoin network? How we use the Bitcoin? I have no clue, guys. I'm not the smartest guy in the room, but I can connect the puzzles, and I can say that the time is now. So, one thing, ideology. What kind of ideas we have? We want to live in the fiat system with the central bank digital currencies as the main fiat, or we want to live in a free world where you want to trade in Bitcoin, here's a Bitcoin. You want to trade, I don't know, in any other shitcoin, here's a shitcoin. You want to trade for, I don't know, other goods like a barter, it's your choice. So, again, my message, if you're 25 plus and you have ideas, and you know that it's the time has come, and I'm telling you the time has come, we have to act now, because if we don't act now, unfortunately, I see that in about 10 years, they're going to get rid of cash, then they're going to say that the crypto is illegal because we have CBDC, and then they will say, here's the social ranking like in China, so everyone has going to have the rank. I'm sure we're not going to have any conferences because they'll be illegal, because crypto is illegal, and so on and so on. So I want to change that past, to be honest. I don't like that future. I like the Bitcoin future back that I drew in 2013. So the first side is ideology. The second thing is how we're going to build it, like physically, because the biggest problem when you talk to the politicians and you tell them about the crypto and the blockchain, they're saying, okay, how does it work? And then you go to the market and say, guys, okay, I need some use cases. Show me how we can use this technology. And there are no use cases because the governments are not proactive, so there is no one to build these services for. So the good news is there are services now to build for, and it's called Ukraine, because we have nothing to lose. We go digital. We have really cool pro-digital, pro-crypto government. I guess that's it, guys. So thank you. So. Yeah, if you don't have any ideas or you're not thinking about it, you can just donate to Ukrainian Crypto Fund. We'll be thankful for that as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Desiree, are you around? Sorry, I'll just take a minute. I'll find Desiree. Hello. Okay, so we're ready to go back again. So, so next, a friend of mine in the space, Desiree, she is doing a lot of interesting stuff with Lightning and Lightning Gaming. So everyone please welcome the CEO of Thunder, Desiree Dickerson.
Can you hear me? Yeah. Okay. Wonderful. Take this down a bit. As Stefan said, it's great to be on stage with Stefan a little bit. We co-hosted the Lightning Conference back in 2019. But like he said, I am Desiree Dickerson, and I am CEO of Thunder Games. Yay. There's our little avatar from our designer of me. But our mission is to bring Bitcoin to the world through play. And today I want to talk a little bit about, one, yes, Bitcoin has the potential to revolutionize the game industry. And we talk a lot about that when we talk about use cases for the Lightning Network. It always comes up and it's very important. But today I also want to get into why Bitcoin gaming is so important for the world in bringing Bitcoin to the world through mobile games. So, again, with the advent of the Lightning Network, adding Bitcoin to games became possible. So, instantaneous, insanely cheap microtransactions just make sense within a game economy, within game worlds, and just the entire gaming environment. And this utility does have the potential, again, to revolutionize everything with games, but a lot of times we are always creating products for the sake of creating products, and that's something that I personally hate in any industry. And so at Thunder, we think a lot about, okay, we're going to create products that actually solve problems and all about solutions. So when thinking about bringing Bitcoin to games, we look at the problems, and there's three major problems, or really three major areas I think we can improve in gaming with Bitcoin and microtransactions. Those three being compensation, value sharing, and more monetization avenues. So I want to get into these three very briefly, and the first, in my opinion, the most important is players. So everyone in this room has probably played a game before, maybe still consider themselves gamers, but if you think about games, it's really a one-way value sync when it comes to players and corporations. So if you're playing, you, one, you're paying for your console, then two, you're paying for the game itself, and then if you're playing on console or PC, you're probably paying for a subscription service, monthly, yearly, whatever, and then you're probably also paying for in-game content and potentially also yourself creating user-generated content or UGC, and you're, at the end of the day, this is all bringing significant value to really, not really developers or studios, but more so distributors and publishers. And you as a gamer, anyone as a gamer, you are not being compensated for anything. And you are they're deriving incredible value from you in terms of your interaction with ads, your interaction with brands, and just generally engaging with the games. And so with Bitcoin and with microtransactions via the Lightning Network, there is a way to share some of that revenue and really compensate people for interacting and being a part of your ecosystem. And two, also in, under the player category, is esports. Esports is over an $11 billion a $1 billion industry, and some of these prizes are insane. So I know we have like some Dota fans in the audience, I'm sure. Like the largest prize pool for Dota 2 was, I believe, $40 million. So this is a huge and growing industry. But the traditional fiat rails makes it really hard to have more than just a few players at the top winning, so you don't have really equitable esports. And what's interesting with borderless, low-fee microtransactions, it allows for wider prize distribution and allows more individuals to participate. And this can also really serve to drive engagement for these tournaments. So at Thunder Games, people literally win one sat, 10 sat. And you know, you can get really creative with like gamified rewards. And we have a prize draw every day that introduces some randomness, and it keeps people coming back, but everybody wins. And more people can be involved with esports just because of the introduction of microtransactions and being able to pay out, or having no minimum thresholds for paying out prize winnings. Then for creators, I know also I do want to preface this saying that I know microtransactions are incredibly controversial in the gaming industry. I know if you think like the Diablo 2 auction house, I know people are not like super hot on the topic now, but there is like a huge landscape change happening. And this is, you know, we're seeing UGC or user-generated content becoming more and more important in game environments. So for instance, everyone here has probably heard of Roblox. They have over 115 million active users. And these users are creating more than 2 billion hours of playable content per month. And these, keep in mind, are mostly children, and they're creating free value for these companies and not being compensated at all. Like, I'm not a lawyer, though, but this sounds like child labor. So I think like microtransactions might be able to save some of these corporations' asses, but we'll see. Similarly, Electronic Arts, or EA, their creator community actually creates more content than its own studio combined. So again, these companies are profiting off of the content that these creators are making, and they are not being compensated in any way whatsoever. So again, if we can introduce microtransactions, even if it's not a lot, these companies should be inclined or should want to compensate these creators, not only because it's fair, but also it will keep them engaged and it will keep them creating content. Then thirdly, and this one also touches Thunder Games directly, is really like the developer and studio problem. Obviously, game economies are super complex. Meat space economies are even more complex. We can't even get those right. And so we're seeing all these Web3 blockchain solutions that really promise the world, and they all fall flat. Like, if you're going to introduce an easily manipulated currency to an in-game economy, it is ultimately only going to lead to failure. However, Bitcoin can obviously be a powerful tool to fix this. So not only is it great for in-game economies, but also Bitcoin offers some other amazing things. One, it increases engagement and retention. Okay, you're giving players real-world value. Obviously, they're going to want to play your game. We have seen this at Thunder Games. We have some great numbers. Our head of analytics is in the office and will murder me if I, you know, start sharing a bunch of numbers, but it is significant. Also, Bitcoin, these small prizes can act as a new tool for Bitcoin-rewarded behavioral incentives. So again, I mentioned our daily prize draw, and that element of randomness really introduces this amazing addictive behavior. Maybe not amazing for all, but amazing for our bottom line that keeps people coming back day in and day out. Also, immediate payouts. People don't think about this, but in the mobile games industry, we are kind of at the will of these ad companies. So there is a 90-day wait till we get paid. So if we're making money on ads, we have to wait 90 days until we see that money. It's fine for larger studios, but if you look at indie, like really small indie studios, and also just, you know, one-off developers, this is incredibly difficult for running any business. Also, Bitcoin, we love Bitcoin because it allows us to circumvent centralized intermediaries. And who are the ones that we personally deal with the most? Google and Apple. And they have just, for years and years, created walled gardens that, and they just continue to monopolize the value chain and take incredibly steep cuts, but also just really, they keep our hands tied behind our backs in terms of what we can keep in the App Store and Google Play. So Bitcoin obviously, hopefully eventually, will allow us to really circumvent Apple and Google at some point. So this is a ton about how Bitcoin can change the games industry. And I've talked about this a lot, written about it, and happy to talk about it more. But one thing that we really think about at Thunder Games, and one thing I think that people don't really talk about, is how gaming can actually allow us to bring Bitcoin to the people that need it most. And there's so many cool projects that are going on, but a lot of times the people who use those projects or products and engage with Bitcoin are not necessarily the people that need it most, and those are the people that we are setting out to serve at Thunder Games. So obviously there's some issues with bringing Bitcoin to everyone, and we talk about them all the time. Onboarding, education, there's so many barriers. Well, I've thought about these things a lot. You know, I've been doing Bitcoin and Lightning specifically for a while, and I have always kind of broken it down to three tenets to optimized onboarding. And I know gaming actually addresses all three of those. So these three tenets are ease, sense of safety, and fun. Ease, I'm talking about really kind of the familiar user flow, or a familiar user flow. So with games, specifically mobile games, that is a user flow we can all relate to. Everyone in this room has apps on their phone. How many people, raise your hands, have a mobile game on their phone? Yes, literally almost everyone. And if you don't, honestly, Thunder Games, just type it in. We have 4 games in the apps on Google Play. You can all download them. But this is a familiar flow. So everybody's downloaded an app before. Most people have played a user or have played a mobile game. You simply download from one of these stores, you play, you win, and you're a Bitcoiner. It's literally one of the most seamless, logical user experiences that someone can do to experience Bitcoin for the first time. And another really great part, there is absolutely no upfront investment, and also very little KYC. No one has to put money into our games before they play. You literally go, and you play, and you win. You do not need to invest anything upfront. Secondly is a sense of safety, and I don't really care what people think, but like most, I mean, I hate Apple, I hate Google, I mean, but most people, they don't. Those places feel incredibly safe to them. They know that if they download an app in one of those stores, that they're probably going to be safe because they know that they're these little sandbox environments. Yes, I hate it, but the rest of the world aren't Bitcoiners yet. And so that sense of safety is an amazing place, an amazing environment to really take and to use and to introduce Bitcoin for the first time. And also, if you're thinking finance, people think Bitcoin, it's money. You want to feel safe when you're interacting with a new currency for the first time. And the third, I say fun up here, but fun is really what's in it for me. A lot of people don't realize, people don't care about Bitcoin. They just don't. They don't get it yet. They don't care about sound money yet. They don't understand the value proposition. They will someday, but how do we first get them to care? And what's in it for them? What's in it for them in mobile games is just the pure joy of play. And I think that's something that a lot of times when we're presenting Bitcoin, we don't think about what's in it for people outside of like speculative value increase. So these are the 3 tenets that I have optimized onboarding and why gaming and Bitcoin make sense. But I also want to talk about why mobile games specifically are absolutely essential into bringing Bitcoin to the people that matter most. So there are 2 audiences specifically that we think about right now at Thunder Games. One are female audiences and emerging markets or developing countries. So if we want to just think about mobile first, and let's talk about female audiences. Of the 1.7 billion people in this world that are unbanked or underbanked, 1 billion of those individuals are women. And so often, financial access means empowerment. So if there's a way that we can bring these women financial access through Bitcoin, there's incredible power in that. Although that statistic is really depressing, the 1 in 1.7 billion, there's a really interesting statistic that I absolutely love that everyone will be shocked about. 63% of all women worldwide play mobile games. And 60% of those women play mobile games every single day. So now you can see what I'm lining up. If women are playing these games can be the perfect conduit for bringing financial access and specifically exposure to Bitcoin to these women. And this is why mobile games are so crucial to this audience. Again, women, emerging markets, these are audiences that are traditionally underserved in terms of financial access, and most certainly Bitcoin. Then moving on to emerging markets and developing countries, gaming has exploded with these audiences just due to the entrance of affordable, low-resource, connected smart devices. Right now we have around an 80% global penetration rate of smart devices. So for instance, what's really interesting, the mobile gaming market is expected to grow to over $66 billion by 2026, and 47% of that growth is projected to originate from the APAC regions. So a lot of this mobile gaming growth we're seeing in these emerging markets. Some other really interesting stats that I found: India, Brazil, and Russia in Q1 of 2021 achieved double-digit year-over-year mobile games downloads. India in 2020 accounted for 12% of all mobile games downloads. And there's just this is just happening everywhere in these emerging markets. These market individuals in these markets can't really access $600 consoles, $1,000+ gaming PCs, but mobile devices present an opportunity for everyone to game. And also, now they're presenting an opportunity for everyone to be able to access Bitcoin. So mobile games, again, they provide an open conduit for bringing Bitcoin to these audiences. These audiences, again, who are traditionally underserved by traditional finance. So, again, when people hear Bitcoin and gaming, a lot of times, especially in this market, people think it's really trivial. It's cute. It's the entertainment industry. And we get overlooked a lot. But, you know, again, like, there's so many, like, there's all these sexy products out there. But, like, I think people are realizing now, people don't care. People don't get it. So mobile games, specifically Thunder Games, present an opportunity to bring people to Bitcoin so they can access the rest of what this industry is building. And something that, this is my favorite statistic of all of these statistics, is that for Thunder users, our entire user base, 80% of our user base is new to Bitcoin. Again, 80%. So 80% of our users, we have brought them their first Bitcoin. And not only do we have the stats for that, but we hear it from people every single day that I would have never learned about Bitcoin. I would have never bought Bitcoin. But since you brought it to me in such a fun way and made it easy, now I'm a Bitcoiner. We're just the beginning of that funnel. We're just the beginning of bringing people onto Bitcoin. So I really encourage everyone here in this room today to reconsider what the power of games and Bitcoin. You can even potentially use games to onboard new users. And at the very least, you can utilize gamified Bitcoin behavioral reward mechanisms, which is what we build into our games, to onboard new users for you. We're happy to help. I'm really just one DM away on Twitter, so we are open to collaborations. So again, mobile games and Bitcoin are really a match made in heaven for onboarding the world to Bitcoin. So I'm asking everyone here in this room to join our mission and save the world with Bitcoin through mobile games. We all know the world is burning, and it is burning hotter every single day. And I'm asking you to save your friends. I'm asking you to save your family. And if they're not going to buy Bitcoin, you sure as hell should get them to download Thunder Games so they can win Bitcoin and help us onboard the world to Bitcoin. Save the world. Play Thunder.
Thank you, Desiree. And yeah, play around with the games. I've had a go. I was playing the racing one, and Bitcoin Bounce is infamous in Bitcoin circles. So give it a try, guys. I think Desiree and the team are doing some awesome stuff. And, you know, it's all Lightning native as well. So that's fantastic. All right. So next up, we have Igor Korsakov. He is working on Blue Wallet. And so this is a really, for those of you who don't know, I'm sure it's a community favorite. You know, they've got Bitcoin, Lightning, multisig, all kinds of stuff. So I'm interested to hear what Igor has to say.
Check, check. One, two. Okay, cool. Where's the first slide? Nice. Okay, so my name is Igor. I'm the creator of Blue Wallet. Yeah, so they gave me like 15 minutes of time, so I decided just to compose a list of facts about Blue Wallet and building wallets in general. So Blue Wallet is an open source Bitcoin-only wallet. Yeah, make it full screen. technology, am I right? Yeah, so Blue Wallet is an open source wallet, right? So open source is actually a wild ride. You get amazing experience out of open source. And the number I like is that we had 200 contributors to Blue Wallet open source. And some people contribute not because they need money, they contribute because they like Twitter likes. They can post stuff to Twitter, they get Twitter likes, they get dopamine. It's fun. Yeah, but it's also hard. Like, I'm noticing a lot of open source software is open source only, like, just because it's expected to be open source. Like, they open their source, and that's it, just fuck off. Take our source and fuck off. We don't care about you, really. But what really they should be focused on is building the community, making people to contribute, contributing back to the other open source projects. So one thing I like to remind myself is that often technology can be replicated, especially in our field of work. Like, if you're trying to patent something, it's usually a dick move. So in open source, you take other people's source code, but what you really can't replicate is human connections. So if you go out, you make some connections with your fellow developers, you help other projects out, this is connections that cannot be replicated. You cannot just copy-paste it like some piece of code. And as Sergei Kotlar recently said, Twitter users don't really mirror correctly the Bitcoin user base. So there is very small intersection between Twitter Bitcoiners and real-life Bitcoiners, and you should always be aware of that. Yeah, and this is the bad part. So if you're building some kind of product and it's successful, scammers will show up, that's for sure. I'm really sad, but some of the use cases for Blue Wallet are like a honeypot for scammers. So I'll give you an example. So we've got a watch-only wallets in Blue Wallets. You can basically import an address and watch the address real-time. You'll get push notifications on top-ups. And what scammers do, they convince you that they're like investment agents. And they convince you to import the address. They will simulate the top-ups on this address. And people think they're investing money, they pay fiat. And this is their investment account. And then they want to withdraw, they can't. They come to us, they complain. A lot of people got wrecked with this. So yeah, scammers will come, be prepared. Yeah, and as I said before, like, there is very small intersection between Twitter users and real Bitcoin users. So I reckon we're actually sleeping on some adoption happening in some weird places in the world. And we're not aware of this because we can't see it. There are some metrics and some usages and some software, but no one can actually connect the dots yet. We don't see it. Like, maybe Thailand, maybe Nigeria. We don't know, really, for the moment. So, because they're not on Twitter, they're not vocal about this. Interesting fact, yeah? Yeah, and yeah, Bitcoin Lightning is cool. It still has chances to fail, actually. Yeah, I like to remind myself as well that Lightning is in beta, right? Bitcoin is still in beta, right? It's kind of still an experiment. So we cannot afford to lose Bitcoin. Lightning, we can afford to lose. It's not the only solution for scalability. If you don't know, you'll be surprised. There are like a dozen of options for to scale Bitcoin. Some of them are purely theoretical right now. Some of them being developed. You probably heard of Fedimint recently, yesterday on this conference. Well, it's important to keep open mind. Like, Lightning is not the only way for scalability. And again, I cannot stress this enough. We cannot afford to lose the base layer. The base layer, if we lose it, I think the world goes to shit. So we should really pay more attention to what's happening on base layer and make more effort to protect it. Yeah, and people like to say that, oh, Bitcoin wallets are hard because it's hard to figure out the UX. It's not the UX that's hard. That's figured out. It's the explanation of Bitcoin. How do you explain to users what is Bitcoin? What is the private key? Where your actual Bitcoins are? Are they on your wallet or actually on blockchain? And what's the relation with the private key? So you should really start with that because the UX is not the hard part. That's the hard part. Yeah, and my co-founder Nuna, he made this point. Yeah, so we should really focus more also on helping the good cause, like helping Hodlanat win the law, the suitcase against fake Toshi, right? So we should help. Another good point, I noticed that a lot of wallets, they try to reinvent the backup mechanism. And it's funny, but BIP39 inventors, they actually claim this is not recommended for adoption. There might be better options. But here we are, like 7 years later, and everyone are using BIP39, unless you're doing some weird stuff with server-assisted multisig, which I personally do not like. So the point is, don't roll your own backup mechanisms. If you'll go with BIP39, there will be interoperability with other software. Your users will be safer. You don't roll your own crypto, so you're not getting wrecked. With a small exception with IZ, which I think is superior. But again, it's not getting any traction except the LND. But it's kind of cool. As a specification, you can look into it, but BIP39 is the king. Yeah, this is my personal experience and a lot of Blue Wallet users' experience. Tor is good at what it does, but for general audience, it's not that great. Like, you get stuck, you get slow connections, you get disconnections, and people come to you asking, why is it working? Why is it so slow? And you have to explain, this is routed through a bunch of hops on the interwebs. This is how it works for privacy. And users don't get it. They want everything to just work. And Tor is not that. So usually Tor is a solution for people who need privacy and they know what they're doing. So maybe we should explore some alternatives to Tor. Maybe there is something better. That's another good point from my co-founder. So to be honest, at this day and age, it's good to have a pseudonym, not to be a real you on their interwebs. So people won't come after you. So if you can, if you're starting building some new stuff, don't dox yourself, be a pseudonym. This will save you your nerves in future. You'll thank yourself later. And we really like BIP37.